Hi, my name is Emily Marion. I'm a computer science professor and I'm a New York City public school parent. A few years ago, my oldest daughter was applying to middle school in New York City. And that's when I learned how New York City was assigning students to schools at various levels. So New York City uses an algorithm that is based on the well-known matching algorithm to assign students to their choice school for pre-K, K, middle school, and high school. So I'm a computer scientist, and one thing I like about algorithm is how it's the mechanism of them, how they are used to apply rules to make a complicated process simpler. And the New York City, the algorithm that New York City uses is based on this well-known stable matching algorithm, and it has a lot of nice properties. The most important one is that it does not provide any incentive to game the system. The best strategy is to put the schools that you wish your students to go to in your true order of preference. The second one is that it's actually a very straightforward and simple algorithm to understand. And I thought that, you know, that would make the process easy for families. Then I realized, talking to other parents, that there was a lot of confusion and a lot of miscommunication around the algorithm and a lot of misunderstandings. I talked to many parents who felt that there was a way to game their choices, or more concerningly, that felt that if they could waste their first choice and then lock their kid out of a school that they wanted. And so that's not the case. So I started explaining the algorithm to various parents in my children's school, and I made a presentation that I gave to various school functions and community events. So based on the feedback that I received, I decided to make a video about this presentation. So my presentation will be in two parts. In the first one, this one, I will explain how the general algorithm works and how students are assigned to school, and I will show why there is no better strategy than being truthful. In the second part, I will explain how the algorithm works when the system has additional constraints, for instance, priorities that for a specific set of students, some schools who have zoned students, some schools have set-asides, or what happens when some of the decisions are made through a lottery. So before I start, I just want to note that I'm not affiliated with the New York City Department of Education. So what is an algorithm? We hear a lot about algorithms, and sometimes the word seems a little scary, but an algorithm is just a set of rules. There's a lot of processes in which you apply rules when you stack numbers to add them and do the carryover. That's an algorithm, right? So the New York City school matching algorithm is a process that orders students and assigns them to schools based on some constraints, based on some rules that you have in the system. There are several set of rules. There you have the school rules. Schools will admit students based on different priorities, different criteria that they have. It could be the screening school have academic achievement requirements, for instance. Some schools have diversity in admission set-asides. There are priority groups, for instance, zone school. Some schools will have essays or interviews. Other schools will have auditions. So each school will have a ranking of students that they in the order they are prioritized for admission. Students, on the other hand, have preferences in terms of the schools they want to choose. And those preferences can be based on any personal decision, maybe some specific education need, maybe they want the school to be close to their home, maybe they want some specific offerings that the school has, and they create a choice list, a preference list, which is what parents and students input in the New York City DOE portal. the algorithm here takes those inputs, the school inputs and the student inputs, and creates an assignment that maximizes some objective function. And the optimization function that the matching algorithm takes is to make the students as happy as possible. Of course, not every student will be happy, but overall, the algorithm that New York City uses wants to make as many students happy. And by happy, I mean having a school that is high as possible in their choice list. So the algorithm was designed in 2003 by three economists who worked in collaboration with the New York City DOE. And it's actually an adaptation of a very well-known algorithm from the 60s that's called the stable marriage algorithm. And it has been used and adapted for various real-life matching problems. The most common one, the most well-known one, is the medical school matching. Many school systems in different cities use variation of this algorithm as well. The benefit of this algorithm is that it provides stable matching. By stable, what we mean is that there is no pair, in our case, student school, that would rather be matched with each other than with the ones they are currently matched with, which doesn't mean that a student may not prefer being matched to another school than the one they got matched to, or a school may have prioritized other students, but pairwise, you won't have a student school that would have preferred, as far as school can prefer, to be matched together. So the application to school matching, the algorithm that is used in New York City is a student proposing a version of the algorithm. What it means is that students are making the first choices. And that's why the algorithm optimizes the student's outcome. We'll see that with the example. If the city had decided to use a school proposing algorithm, the algorithm will still have the stable property. It will still optimize and create optimize the output and create assignment, but it will optimize the output for the schools, not for the students. So it's better for students' outcome to be a student proposing a version of the algorithm. So the way the algorithm works is that it creates tentative matches, and the algorithm iterates and changes and updates its matches as it gets new information, which is why you're not penalized for putting in your lists the school in the true order of preference, because there's no way you're locking yourself out of a school, or you know, there's no prioritization of students who put a school as number one. If a student who put a school at number three comes up for that school and is higher in the school priority list, they'll still get the school ahead of a student who put that school number one. The key for that is tentative match. As the algorithm proceeds, it matches students to school, but it will reassess those matchings until every student is assigned. And so at any point in time, a school will hold space for the students that he has seen so far that are their best ranked students. But if a higher ranked student, as far as that school is concerned, comes up, then it will give them priority and assign them and release another student. So another interesting property of the algorithm is, regardless of which order you process the students, if you process them in batch, if you process them one by one, you will still reach the same outcome. So let's look at an example here. We have three schools, the red school, the blue school, the yellow school. Each school has two available spots. And each school has prioritized the students based on their own criteria, right? We have six students. So Ali, B, Cal, Dan, Eva, and Flo. Student F is Flo. So the student with the highest priority in school red is Flo, student F. And for each student, we have a choice of school, first, second, and third. And that's self-explanatory. So in this version, I'm going to do it by a batch. And I'm going to look at first all the first choices of all the students. So right now, we have Ali, B, and Eva, who put the red school as first choice, and Cal, Dan, and Flo put the blue school as first choice. However, each school only has two spots. So only two of the students, for each for the red school and the blue school can be assigned temporarily. Remember, it's a tentative assignment to the school. So based on the priority list that each school keeps, we'll get Eva and Ali will get the spot in the red school, and Cal and Dan will get the spot in the blue school, which means that at this point we have tentatively matched 4 of the students, but 2 of the students, B and Flo, have no match. Right. So for those 2 students, we're going to look at their next preference. Now, B's second choice is the blue school, and Flo's second choice is the yellow school. So for Flo, it's easy. There is still space available in the yellow school, and so Flo can have a spot at, tentatively, a spot at the late yellow school. B, however, her second choice is the blue school, which is already full with 2 students tentatively assigned, but B's priority in the blue school is higher. So she will get a spot, and the school will release the assignment of Dan, who is the lowest ranked student at that school out of the 3 students who are currently assigned to the school. So now B and Cal are assigned to the blue school, and Flo is assigned to the yellow school. We're now looking at the next choice of students who don't have any assignment, and at this point we only have Dan without an assignment. Dan's next choice is the red school. However, the red school is already full, and Dan's priority in the red school list is lower than that of the 2 students, Eva and Ali, who are already in the school, tentatively be assigned to the school, so Dan will not get that spot. So now we're looking at the next choice for Dan, who is the last student without an assignment at this point. And the next choice is the yellow school, which still has a seat available, so Dan gets assigned to the yellow school. And now all the students have a tentative assignment, which becomes their final assignment, and we have Ali and Eva assigned to the red school, B and Cal to the blue school, and Dan and Flo to the yellow school. Now you can see that despite the fact that you had 3 students, Cal, Dan, and Flo, putting the blue school as their first choice, B, who put this blue school only as her second choice, got the seat ahead of them because she is ranked higher on the blue school list, even though, and of course, if she had been assigned to the red school, then that would have been her match. But because she wasn't assigned to the red school, she's not penalized for having put the blue school as her second choice. So that shows you that there is the best strategy is always to put your true order of preference because you're not being penalized for not doing this. So that's the end of the first part. I hope that you have a better understanding of the algorithm and that I convinced you that the best strategy is to be truthful. In the second part, I will discuss how the algorithm operates when we have priorities, set-asides, zoning, and some assignments given through lottery numbers.